like to welcome all of you to 33rd Armadillo Con. We are very proud of our lineup this year, thanks in part to my co-chair here, Ms. Jennifer Dupay. Guest of honor. So you can thank her for our lineup this year. That's a really good lineup. And before I make a fool of myself trying to, you know, extemporaneously speech here, I'd like to pass it on to our Toastmaster, Mark Finn. Yes. Last, my suit of power.
Be afraid.
You have to forgive me. It's been a very rough week. I've had a lot on my plate.
That's a big stack of cards.
Hence the notes, okay? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. What? You need the mic for me?
Wow.
Yeah. Pretty hard of hearing.
Oh, actually, it needs to go up. There's volume. Where is it?
Here?
Oh, no, it is. How about now?
There's no cord plugged into it.
Nothing's wireless.
It's wireless.
Yeah.
No, we're dead. We're dead in the water.
Opening ceremonies needs tech support.
Check, check, check.
That's wireless. It's still wireless.
Well, is your notes, Mark?
All right, well, he works on that. I'll speak from a position of authority. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I suppose you're wondering why I called you all here tonight. It's because one of you is a murderer. Wait, hold on.
Sure.
Okay, here we go. Good. All right. Good. It's a privilege to be here tonight at the 37th Annual North Texas Projectionist Union Lodge meeting. And speaking of which, how do you adjust the frame rate on a Christie Simplex bottle up projector, huh? Practice, practice. Hold on. Here we go. Welcome to ArmadilloCon, the preeminent literary SF convention of the Southwest. I am your Toastmaster, Mark Finn. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for choosing to spend your weekend here in sunny, delightful Austin, Texas, located conveniently at the mouth of hell itself, for all of your convection-baking needs. This heat is killing me, man. It's causing tempers to flare. I'm serious. This is the kind of weather where you can actually kill a person and invoke the he needed killing defense and get away with it. It actually nearly happened to me the other day. Let me explain. No, there is no time. I sum up. The other day, a teenager came into my movie theater. He was wearing a Star Wars t-shirt, okay? Specifically, a diagram drawing of R2-D2. Very cool. So he comes up to me with his ticket. I pointed at his shirt, and I said, Boutini! It was a natural reaction. Now, what I fully expected him to do was look down at his shirt and say, I lost R2. Again, the normal response. Instead, he looked at me like this. So, thinking he'd forgotten that he had on his R2-D2 shirt today, because sometimes that happens to me, I pointed and said, your shirt, R2-D2, the Jawas... Come on, man, don't leave me hanging, brother. The kid looks down and then does this. Oh, this. I've never seen Star Wars. Then why do you have on an R2-D2 t-shirt? Without blinking, the little savage rolled his eyes like Claire Danes, looked at me and said, it's like a joke, you know, irony. Do you see this goatee? Okay? I'm over 40. I'm a member of Generation X. I'm an aging hipster. I'm familiar with irony, all right? Back when I was in high school, they used to actually teach it in English class, okay? Don't talk to me about irony, you snot-nosed little heathen. I was ironic before you were even born. Oh, hold on. Looks like we're ready. Toastmaster.
That is picky enough.
There's more coming. This trend, this ironic trend, really bothers me because it skews the geek identification and classification system. It messes my geekdar up really bad. And it's irritating because it ignores the clearly established rules of self-branding. I'll go over them for those of you who might need a brief refresher. From the looks of it, some of you do. You can wear a t-shirt that advertises any brand of clothing that you actually wear. Nike, Converse, Levi's, all fair game, provided you actually wear that brand. Anything else on a t-shirt that's not a clothing brand can be worn if, A, you use or eat the product in question. Self-explanatory. B, it's got a catchphrase on it that you believe in. Something classy like Keep Austin Weird or Where's the Beef? Or you won the t-shirt, say at a state fair or through a radio call-in show. And if that's the case, you are obligated to let people know that apologetically if necessary. Okay? Hey, Guns N' Roses? What? I ate a corn dog at the fair. They gave me this. It was laundry day. I hate this bit. Yeah, sorry about that. Okay, see ya. That's just polite. That's just a nice thing to do. This is doubly important when we're dealing with pop culture franchises, okay? Now, the reason why we wear our favorite movies and TV shows on our shirt is to correctly identify other members of our tribe. It's a Sneetch star, okay? So when you go out in public and you've got a Star Wars t-shirt on, I don't expect you to know the hatch number on the trash compactor door on the Death Star. It's 3263827, okay? I'm just saying. But if I ask you what your favorite movie of the three is, you'd better have an answer for me, and ideally it should be The Empire Strikes Back.
Where's the butter?
It's a difficult responsibility.
Or he could
first for the audience or you.
Oh, toast!
Make note of this brand. It's crispy. It's really well.
Yes. It's important that we start getting together without irony, okay? Because here's the deal, folks. We are at a crossroads in modern society. I don't know if any of you guys are paying attention to what's going on right now, but things kind of suck. Okay? We can't get anything done. We're too divided. We've moved to the ends instead of to the middle. Republicans and Democrats don't get along. Conservatives and liberals don't get along. The religious and the scientific don't get along. But we can. We do get along. Think about it. Not only are we as a group educated, but we're also creative and compassionate. That's right, compassionate. Now, I can prove to you this compassion. Every single one of you has in your group of friends, all right, someone who drives you right up the frickin' wall. You're nodding. Well, you're already starting to nod. Every one of you has one. Whether it's your science fiction book group or your Sunday board game group or your cyberpunk sewing circle or your Torchwood recreation guys that go out on whatever. Whatever the group is, whatever you're into, you've got at least one group asshole. And as a quick aside, if you're sitting there right now going, there's no one like that in my group, then it's probably you. So we've all got one, all right? But do we ever kick them out? No. Do we ever pull them to the side and give them a little talking to? No. What do? Well, you know, when he's on his meds, he's not a total jerk. His feet don't smell that bad when he takes his shoes off at the table and we're all trying to eat. You know, it's always something. You know, we make excuses. We put up with them. And why? Because at the end of the day, in our hearts, they are our friends. It's that simple. So the rest of the world is divided and angry. They don't talk, but that they scream. They go to an extreme position on everything, and they stand there and defend that ground as if it were really their own. And nothing gets done. Discourse is stifled. Thoughts and ideas aren't exchanged. All right? Cyberpunk came true. We're living in it right now.
Yeah, brother!
of resistance. I'm talking about some common ground that we can all agree on, okay? The prime directive. We can all agree on that. The power of the force. We can all agree on that. The Green Lantern Oath, before the movie. We can all agree on that. You know what I'm talking about. It's always been, if you are a member of our rarefied society, who you are is less important than the stuff you like, the things that you're into. All right? We forgive a lot if they like the same things we do. We put up with repellent hygiene, bad manners, women and men who are emotionally retarded and bad for us. Why? Well, he's the only other person I know who likes to play buddies and burrows with me, you know? Or, oh, I know she's got a basket full of snakes for brains, but she loves Jeffrey Combs just as much as I do. Some of you look, Jeffrey Combs is an actor. He played Wayoon in Deep Space Nine. He was Herbert West, Reanimate. Okay, never mind. I'm just going to keep going. The point is this. It's through our compassion that we can change the world. All right? Here's how we do it. Your homework assignment, nay, your sacred mission, next week, find and identify one person that has a different divisive social or political agenda from you. Can I delegate? Hey, everybody works at Armadillocon, okay? Go make friends with that person. Not the way normal people make friends, okay? That way leads to madness, chaos, and death. You know that. Do it the way we do it, okay? That's right. I say we start recruiting actively, all right? I skipped one.
We didn't notice.
Yeah, it's all right. Hey, Marjorie, I notice you seem to like bitter political infighting that goes nowhere, does nothing, and never seems to end. Can I interest you in this book of Game of Thrones? Tell me I'm wrong! Tell me I'm wrong! Okay, hey, Jeff, you seem to value personal freedom among all other things in your personal arsenal. Have you ever seen the show Firefly? This is how we get them. This is how we pull them in. We start recruiting in hard and we bring these people into our world, okay? A world of tolerance. A world without judgment or recriminations, unless you're a furry. And while we're on the subject, all right, I want to address something that's come up over the years at Armadillocon. Okay, you guys probably know that, you know, for my sins, I've never understood furries and furry culture. I never have, I probably never will, I just don't get it. It's my failing, and I accept it and take full responsibility for it. You guys also probably know that I am unapologetically pro-simian. Okay?
Yeah.
I'm building my own gorilla suit, as long as my wife lets me. And if I had my druthers, I would have a pair of gorilla arms instead of these inferior objects. Alright? Over the years, a few of you smart arses out there have tried to trap me up, you know, that box me in with, well, if you want to be a gorilla, doesn't that make you a furry? No. No, it doesn't, and I can prove this with math, okay? The difference between humans and apes is less than 2% of our DNA. All right? For some of you, it's less than 1%. Where's Rick Claw? Hey, buddy.